Well, in the 16th century, the great reformer Martin Luther wrote a song which many of us are familiar with, and in this song, A Mighty Fortress, he writes the following words. He says, "And though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his triumph, his truth to triumph through us." Now, Martin Luther knew his Bible. That's why he was able to write these words. He knew what Jesus Christ taught. He knew that the world is full of devils. Now, despite Jesus' clear teaching on the topic of demons and Satan, in our modern world, it can be almost embarrassing to talk about the invisible evil spirit beings. It's even more potentially embarrassing to believe that they exist. It's almost laughable to talk about it in the broader culture. Well, why is this the case? Martin Luther could write great songs about this theme. Well, it's because we live in a world dominated by something called materialism. Now, I don't mean the desire to acquire more and more stuff, though that, of course, is alive as well. I mean the belief held by most people in Western societies that matter alone is real. Like physical stuff, matter alone is the only thing that's real. All that you can believe about the world is what you can prove by science, would be another branch of materialism. The problem is, of course, science can't prove that that statement is true. The rest of history up to this point would agree with the disregard of this affirmation that all you can believe is what science can affirm. The rest of history and the majority of the world right now believe in spiritual beings, good spiritual beings, evil spiritual beings. The majority of the world believes in this. And yet we, in the current modern world and in the so-called enlightened West, struggle with the idea that the world is filled with devils. Now, if matter alone is real, as we're tempted to believe, and I come along and say the world is full of invisible devils, and by that I mean spiritual beings who roam the earth under the authority of their ruler, the prince of the power of the air, who is a liar and a roaring lion, we all grimace if we thought maybe one of my non-believing friends would hear this. If we affirmed out loud, "I believe there are evil spiritual beings and they are influencing people," we would grimace. We've been trained to believe that matter alone is real. Our instinct is to say, let's just stick to the basics, right? Let's go to church and let's talk about Jesus. Let's sing his praises. Why do we need to embarrass ourselves with talk about devils and Satan, you might be thinking? Well, the reason we need to talk about Satan and devils is because our task tonight is to talk about Jesus. And tonight, Jesus wants to talk about Satan. He wants us to know that he and Satan are not rivals in any way. He wants us to know he has conquered Satan. He wants us to know that we still have skirmishes with Satan and we're afflicted by Satan even after we become Christians. Jesus wants us to know people in the world are either following him or enslaved to Satan. The truth that Jesus is putting forward tonight is a hard one for us to ponder. It's hard for us to access this emotionally, or at least it is for me. Our imaginations, as I've said, are shaped by the culture we live in and the stories around us. And the stories of our culture are steadily convincing us that all that is real is the material world and that there is no invisible reality. But what if it's true? What if the world is full of devils, as Martin Luther penned? What if it is true that Satan is real, as our passage seems to indicate? What if it's true that he's a liar and an accuser and a roaring lion seeking someone to devour? What if that's true? What if one of his main tactics is to convince you that he doesn't exist? I mean, could there be any more potent strategy for destruction? A French poet in the 19th century, Charles Baudelaire, warns us against this tactic. He says, "Never, my brethren, forget, when you hear enlightenment vaunted, that the neatest trick of the devil is to persuade you that he does not exist." Now, all of this by way of introduction to remind us about the reality of the demonic world, the reality of Satan. It's to shock us into the worldview, really, of the Bible. Well, consider a few passages in case you need a little bit more evidence. 1 Peter 5:8 says, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." Or 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 17 and 18, Paul's saying that he wants to go see the Thessalonians, but he was hindered. He says, "We wanted to come to you, I, Paul, again and again, but Satan hindered us." Or John 8:44, one of the most important passages on Satan. "The devil was a murderer from the beginning," Jesus says, "and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies." Now, in summary, you should know now, at least, or be reminded of the truth that demons are evil, fallen, created beings who have a leader named Satan. They are not in all places at once. They are not all-knowing, but they are powerful, and they are literally hell-bent on keeping people from Jesus and attacking those who follow him. But thankfully, our passage tonight, our passage tells us, and the rest of the Bible declares, that Jesus has conquered Satan. The rest of the Bible and our passage tonight declares that Jesus has conquered Satan and he has exerted his power over the prince of the power of the air, as Paul calls him in Ephesians 2. And so we're going to focus on Jesus' power tonight over Satan through three movements. This passage is focused on Jesus' power over Satan through three movements. First, we see a demonstration of Jesus' power over Satan. That's verse 22. Second, we see interpretations of Jesus' power over Satan. It's 23 through 29. And then 30 through 37, we see implications of Jesus' power over Satan. Demonstration, interpretation, and implications, all focused on Jesus' power over Satan. Now, with our imaginations hopefully somewhat reshaped and rekindled by the word, and with a belief in the reality of Satan, which this passage assumes, and demons, and the invisible realm, let's look at each of these sections. First, let's see a demonstration of Jesus' power over Satan in verse 22. So look with me. Matthew has just focused on Jesus' healing ministry and his role as the servant of the Lord who is anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let me read briefly from the previous section. If you don't have a Bible with you, Matthew 12, 15, Jesus, aware of this, withdrew from there, and many followed him, and he healed them all and ordered them not to make him known. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. "Behold, my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved, with whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he will proclaim justice to the Gentiles." You notice the connection between healing and the spirit. Now, continuing this theme of spirit-empowered healing, Matthew tells us a blind and mute man was brought to Jesus. That's our passage tonight. A blind and mute man was brought to Jesus. The fact that Matthew mentions he is demon-oppressed and blind and mute makes it appropriate for us to assume, as the passage later clarifies, that the demon is causing him to be blind and mute. He is an oppressed man, right? Who's oppressing him? The demon. What are the things we know about him? He's blind and mute. He is blind and mute because of the demon oppression. So when Jesus heals him, he demonstrates his power, not just over his blindness, not just over his muteness, but over the fact that a demon is oppressing him. Jesus is demonstrating his power over demons in this passage. Now, what does Matthew want us to conclude based on the previous section about the Holy Spirit and healing, and this section, and the following? Well, Jesus heals and demonstrates his power over Satan by the Spirit. Jesus heals and demonstrates his power over Satan by the Spirit. That's what the previous section is emphasizing. He's anointed by the Spirit, connected to his healings. Now he's doing another healing. Well, we can assume that Matthew wants us to be thinking about the Spirit, because obviously the next section highlights that. So Jesus heals and demonstrates his power over Satan by the Spirit. Now, how do people who are around respond to Jesus' power? There are people who have just seen what just happened. That brings us to our next section, the interpretation of Jesus' power over Satan. Jesus has just demonstrated his power, and now people are there watching, and they see it happen, and they're interpreting the evidence. They're interpreting this encounter. And the first group to interpret are the people, the general people. Verse 23, "All the people were amazed and said, 'Can this be the son of David?' Or to put it another way, is this the Christ? Or to put it another way, is this the Messianic King? Well, why did they think this? Why did they ask this question? They're trying to interpret the facts, right? Why did they ask it? Well, they brought a story with them to this encounter. They brought a narrative. They brought a story about God's covenantal love. And they thought, maybe this is the Son of David. Why? Well, Ezekiel 34, probably one of your favorite chapters. Ezekiel 34, a passage which actually tells us a lot about the state of Israel. In Ezekiel 34:4, the weak you have not strengthened. Ezekiel's condemning the leaders. He says, the weak you have not strengthened, the sick you have not healed, the injured you have not bound up. He's accusing the leaders of all the things they failed at. Now, what is God's solution in Ezekiel 34 to this problem that the leaders are failing continually, specifically in healing? What's his solution? Ezekiel 34:23, just later in the chapter, says, God speaking, I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them, and he shall be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince among them. I am the Lord, I have spoken. The people see the healing and the power, and they think, is this Ezekiel 34? Is this the Son of David? Well, the Israelites had a great hope in the Son of David. God had made a covenant with David, a binding promise with David and his household. And it's important for you to know where this comes from. It's from 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 12 and 13. David wants to build a house for God, but God says, no, I will build a house for you. That is a family for you. 2 Samuel 7, 12 through 13 highlight the covenant with David when God first made it. He says, when your days are fulfilled, David, and you lie down with your fathers, that's when you die, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. They still hope in that covenant, and they see healing. The people are bringing a story with them to Jesus' encounter with this blind and mute man. And the story is that a son of David's going to come and he's going to heal because God promised that there would be a king on his throne forever. They know good shepherds are supposed to heal the sheep. They know the promises of Ezekiel. So they think, if this is the Son of David and he is conquering our enemies, even the invisible spiritual enemies like demons, then he is the Messiah. That's what they're starting to wonder. And Messiah, of course, is the Hebrew word for anointed. Anointing happens when the Spirit comes on someone. The Greek word for anointed is Christ. Well, John the Baptist was asking the same question in the previous chapter. Jesus, I'm in prison. Are you the Christ? Some of you remember. People are starting to realize that Jesus is the Messiah, is the Christ, is the Son of David. And the Pharisees, who are the current ruling religious Jewish class, they're the current leaders who are interpreting and applying the law, they realize what's happening. They realize what's happening. And they're threatened, so they offer their own interpretation of Jesus' power. Our next section, the interpretation by the Pharisees. Look at verse 24. But when the Pharisees heard it, that is he the Son of David? When they heard it, they said, it is only by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that this man casts out demons. Now notice what they cannot say. It isn't real. Materialism, the only plausible interpretation for this. It's not real. Notice they cannot say that. They can't say that demons aren't real. They can't say the healing wasn't real. No, they see the power. And they cannot deny it. They cannot deny that something supernatural is happening. So they have to find another explanation. Well, what else could they suggest besides that he's the Messiah, the Son of David of Ezekiel 34 and 2 Samuel 7 and Psalm 89? What else could they conclude? They suggest, he's using the power of a bigger demon. He's using the power of the prince of demons. This is what Jesus is doing. He's doing something supernatural, but no, he's not the Messiah. Instead, he's using the power of the prince of demons. That's what we'll go with. It's their only way to interpret the data and not lose power. But it's a damning interpretation for them and as an accusation against Jesus. But they're desperate. The Pharisees are trying to protect their power by accusing Jesus of using evil power. They're trying to protect their power by accusing Jesus of using evil, demonic power. Now, this gets them in serious trouble. I mean, serious trouble, the worst kind of trouble, because Jesus offers his own interpretation of the incident. Now, look with me at 25 through 29. Now, Jesus offers the conclusion that it's by the Spirit of God that he does this, and that it's a sign that the kingdom of God has come. And the way he deconstructs their argument is by showing that it's illogical and inconvenient. Jesus uses logic to show their argument makes no sense whatsoever and pushes everyone who's listening, and undoubtedly them themselves and us, of course, as well, in the direction that it is by the Spirit of God. Now, let's see how it's illogical. Knowing their thoughts, he said to them, this is verse 25, every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste. No city or house divided against itself will stand. If Satan casts out Satan, he's divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? If you are right, then Satan is destroying his kingdom, Jesus says to the Pharisees. If you are right, then Satan is destroying his own empire. That doesn't make any sense, does it? Not only does it not make sense, it's inconvenient for you and your crew, your followers, your sons, as he says. Look at what they're doing. He says, if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons cast them out? If they could appeal to the Spirit of God, why can't I? But if you're accusing me of appealing to a higher power, Beelzebub, another name for the prince of demons, if you're accusing me of that, then who are they casting out demons by? Because they're affiliated with you. It's a very inconvenient statement you made by accusing me of working with the evil powers. Well, they will be your judges, Jesus says. Your sons, your people. If this is the sort of inconvenient argument that you want to make, well, Jesus is establishing clearly the inconvenience and the illogical nature of their argument. Instead, he puts forth his own positive interpretation. Instead, Jesus teaches that he heals and demonstrates his power by the Spirit. The same theme of the previous section. Isaiah 42, the servant, is the story of Jesus being anointed with the Holy Spirit because of his healings. Then we see the healing happen in the previous section, and now we see Jesus focus on the Spirit of God. He says, if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. If it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. He poses another question. Or how can someone enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man? Then indeed he may plunder his house. Jesus' answer is indicating some very clear things about himself and about the work of the Holy Spirit. He is affirming that he is the Son of David. Why? Because he's saying the kingdom has come through what I'm doing. He's refuting the accusation that it's the power of demons, and instead saying it's by the Holy Spirit. He's saying, if that's true, then the kingdom has come. He's agreeing with the people who are saying, maybe it's the Son of David. He's saying, yes, it is the Son of David. Not only that, he's saying that the Spirit has come in a climactic way. Joel 2 talks about the Spirit coming at the end times in a climactic way, that it would be poured out in a special and even enhanced sense. The Spirit was known in the Old Testament, but he's known even more in the New Testament, in more power and more beauty and more vigor, and Jesus is saying that this is coming. What is he doing? Well, the Spirit's binding Satan. The Spirit has come, and he has taken Satan, and he has tied ropes around him, and he has bound him up. Why? So that Jesus can rescue people from Satan's house, so that he can rescue us from Satan's house, so he can rescue us from the lies that we all have been born into believing about ourselves and about the world and about each other. Jesus has come and he has bound Satan by the Holy Spirit. And when we read this passage originally, we think, oh yeah, it's probably a passage about, you know, Jesus being king. It's a Christological meditation. Well, this is a story about us. We were in Satan's house. That's where we were living. Until Jesus came and bound the strong man way stronger than us. But but not stronger than Jesus. The one Jesus is able to bind so that he can plunder, that is, rescue people, plunder and rescue us from evil. Unfortunately, we, like the Pharisees just now do in our sin, we assume the worst about the Spirit of God. We assume the worst about the Spirit of God. All that glorious truth we just meditated on and hopefully were encouraged by in our sin, we assume the worst about the Spirit of God through our doubt, through our disbelief. The Pharisees, we're going to see, are blaspheming the Holy Spirit by ascribing what the Spirit is doing to the work of Satan. They're assuming the worst. There couldn't be a worse interpretation about what Jesus is doing by healing this man. They assume the worst, and we too, I believe, in our sin, not in our new creation state, but in our sin, which still is afflicting us and bringing its influence on us. In our sin, we assume the worst. And how do we do that? Well, by neglecting the Holy Spirit in our lives. We assume he's not worth our time. We assume that it's not worth our time to meditate on God's word and that God promised that he would speak through his word by his Spirit to us. We neglect that. It's us assuming the worst about the Holy Spirit. No, we're not blaspheming the Spirit, but we are assuming the worst. The same tendency that they had comes out in us, and we assume the worst, and we neglect the word of God. We neglect the Lord's Supper. Well, what happens in the Lord's Supper? We feed on Christ by the Spirit of God. We neglect it. We neglect it. We rarely engage in prayer so as to have fellowship with the Father and the Son by the Spirit. It's us assuming the worst about the Spirit. We don't make time to spend time with the Holy Spirit. And when it seems like God's kingdom is advancing by the Spirit in our sin, we can assume the worst about the Spirit of God and doubt that it's actually real. We hear about somebody growing fruit by the Spirit. They're zealous for the Lord. Maybe they've been able to conquer by the Spirit some sin. In our sin, we doubt that it's real. We find other explanations like the Pharisees. We rationalize it away. We do anything we can in our sin to not concede that the Spirit is alive and working right now, that Jesus is exerting his healing power on his church by the Spirit right now and growing fruit in his church right now by his Spirit. We doubt. We doubt. But this gets us back to our introduction. The reason we doubt is because we have believed a lie that comes from Satan, that all there is what we can see. We have been drinking in the culture so deeply, the stories of our culture, the narratives of our culture, that all there is what we see. It is nearly impossible for us to affirm, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, like our confessions and our creeds affirm. It's so difficult, and yet Jesus is here pushing against us and pushing against that cultural norm and trying to instead draw us back to the reality that the Spirit is working and that Jesus works by the Holy Spirit of God in our lives right now. He's pushing back on the lies that Satan has inflicted upon us, the father of lies. Now, lies are myriad. They're never ending. They keep coming. That's why we come to church every week, to keep reminding ourselves of the truth, because the father of lies is at work, but he is bound. I hope you can see even more why this passage and story are so important and glorious for our confidence in the Lord. He has bound Satan. All that he is up to and all that he is doing are just mere skirmishes. Jesus has conquered him. All of his efforts to bring lies, to convince us and attempt to convince us that he's not real and that the Holy Spirit's not real, all of his efforts and his flaming arrows that bring us doubt, all of his attempts to fan into flame our anger, to make us assume the worst about other people, all of the ways he is seeking to harm our worship and bring malice against our worship, all the things that he's trying to do, Satan has been bound. He's been conquered. That's what this passage is trying to convince us of. We need to hear in a fresh and new way that Jesus heals and demonstrates his power over Satan by the Spirit, and that the way we access the Spirit of God and enjoy all that Jesus is doing in our lives, the way that we access and enjoy the Spirit of God is by his word and by prayer and by taking the Lord's Supper and watching people get baptized. It's how the Spirit is pouring into our hearts Jesus' healing and power and reconvincing us afresh that he is king, that his kingdom has come. That's how we resist the lies that Satan is still trying to push upon us. Because the entire point of this passage is that Satan is bound, and instead that Jesus is king. And his kingdom is a place of radical forgiveness. This is another lie that we're tempted to disbelieve, that Jesus doesn't actually forgive us, that we do have to earn our way into his kingdom, that we have to have enough merit for him to call us friend, to call us brother and sister, to call us his bride, that we have to earn our way into that status. But instead, look at 31 and 32. Look at 31 and 32. The fresh reminder of the forgiveness that Jesus offers. We get distracted by the stuff about blaspheming the Holy Spirit, and understandably so. It's confusing, and it's charged. But Jesus is saying in those words that forgiveness is offered to those who blaspheme his name. He's saying, I forgive you. Not only that, this passage wants us to be convinced that he is protecting us from Satan. He binds up the evil power of this world. The evil can no longer rule you. The Spirit of God will come, and Jesus, the good king, will be your king. That's what Jesus is teaching us. Now, nevertheless, the darkness of this world is real, and there is a power behind it. And the power's name is Satan, which really means accuser. I think that's why Jesus emphasized his forgiveness. Because we grow tired and afflicted by this constant barrage of accusations against our conscience, constant barrage of accusations that we aren't really forgiven, that we're too sinful for Jesus. But the kingdom of Christ is a place of forgiveness and healing. That's what he's trying to press on us. And how does he accomplish his power in our lives? By the Holy Spirit. And how do we resist Satan's attacks? Well, Paul tells us by wearing the whole armor of God. We see this in Ephesians 6. We see that we are to resist Satan, the devil, and all of his scheming, his lies, by the word and prayer and the gospel and the outpouring of the Spirit. That's what we are to do. Why? Because Jesus has conquered him, our passage says. And then we access that victory. We access the victory that Jesus has won, his binding. We access it through all of the armor of God. How do we access the truth that Jesus has conquered Satan, that his accusations are lies? How do we access that? By the armor of God. That's what Ephesians 6 tells us. Not only that, we access it by reminding ourselves of the cross. In Colossians 2, we get the exposition of what happens when Jesus binds the strong man. He says, and you, Colossians 2, 13 through 15, you who were dead in your trespass and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. Rulers and authorities is another way of talking about the demonic powers. It's another way of talking about Satan. He disarmed. He took away the power. He bound the strong man. How? By the cross, by triumphing over them in him. Now, through his ministry and his death and his resurrection, as we've said, he bound Satan. Now, Satan, as I've said, can still afflict those. If you're wondering why you're struggling, he can still afflict those who acknowledge that Jesus is king, but he cannot prevail over you. Satan cannot prevail over you. One little word shall fail him. Now, this knowledge should give you great thanks. great gratitude, great praise. When you read this story, you should be like the blind and the mute man. It's the emotional effect it should have on you. I get to hear this news is true by the Spirit. I get to respond with praise. We should be thankful. Nevertheless, through Satan's lies, we were held captive, but Christ has freed us, and because of that, we can be thankful. Well, to conclude, we've seen the demonstration of Jesus' power over Satan. We've seen interpretations of Jesus' power over Satan. We've meditated on the truth that Jesus' power over Satan is accomplished by the Spirit, and that the Spirit is working right now to convince us of Jesus' healing and of Jesus' forgiveness, and that we are in his kingdom. But there are implications of what Jesus has said. And let's turn now, implications of Jesus' power, verses 30 through 37. Now, verse 30, what Jesus is teaching us through verse 30 is that neutrality is not an option. Neutrality is not an option. Either you are for him or against him. Now remember, you might think, oh, this is a little narrow, Jesus. But he's talking about which kingdom you are in. Either you're in the kingdom of Satan or the kingdom of God. That's why neutrality isn't an option. If you are here thinking this is all a little bit too intense, that's actually the right response. Jesus isn't narrowing that middle ground in his gospel. He's making it clear that you have to respond to who he is. Neutrality is not an option. Not only that, verses 31 through 32, neutrality is akin to blasphemy. Neutrality is akin to blasphemy. If you have learned of Christ like the Pharisees, 31, 32 tell us, if you have learned of Christ like the Pharisees, you have seen his power. You've seen that through Jesus you can receive forgiveness, and the Spirit draws you to Christ and calls you to submit to this truth and to bring your life into conformity to his kingdom by acknowledging him as king. If you've seen what he can do, and the Spirit brings you up close to see that, and you say, no, I don't want to submit to Jesus. That's blasphemy. That's the unforgivable sin. That's blasphemy. We wrestle out, what's the unforgivable sin? It harms our conscience. We don't know how to deal with it. The reality is, it's very clear. The Pharisees called the work of Jesus healing someone by the Holy Spirit, they called it the work of Satan. They saw his power, they resisted his kingdom, and instead ascribed his power to Satan. It is very clear and specific what the unforgivable sin is. It's to recognize Jesus' power and for the Holy Spirit to bring you up close and personal with it and for you to declare, no. That's the unforgivable sin. If you think this is dramatic, remember the Pharisees were calling the work of the Spirit the work of Satan. Now, that work of calling the work of the Spirit satanic ultimately brings condemnation. That's our final reality that we see in this passage. In 33 to 37, I'll summarize. Jesus says you're either for him or against him, like the way a tree brings forth good fruit or evil fruit. A tree doesn't bring forth neutral fruit. It's either good fruit or evil fruit. Or like the way a person brings forth good treasure from a good treasure or evil treasure. There's no middle treasure, Jesus says. You're one or the other. And in the end, what you say will be the basis of your justification. That's his conclusion here. What you say will be the basis of your justification. Will you say that he is the son of David? Will you say that he is the king? Will you submit to the Spirit's power bringing healing and forgiveness into your life? Will you submit to that when the Spirit brings you close and say, yeah, he's king? Or will you say, Jesus' focus here is on words, or will you say, no, Jesus is working by the power of Satan? Or, more common in our culture, will you just say, this isn't real. And none of this is real. Will you assume the worst, just like the Pharisees? Maybe you're not going to conclude, yeah, it's the work of Satan, but you will conclude, this isn't real. Attempt to take a neutral option, which Jesus says doesn't exist. When Jesus says you'll be justified by your words, yes, he could mean whether you say good things or bad things on a regular basis and you'll be judged by your merit. I don't believe it's possible that that's what Jesus could be concluding here. Some sort of works-based righteousness. No, I believe what he is concluding, and consistent with the rest of the Bible, is that your confession that Jesus is King, the Son of David, will be your justification. It'll be your statement of faith. It will be the way you access the work of the cross where he triumphed on your behalf. But if you conclude otherwise, verse 37 says, by your words you will be justified, or by your words you will be condemned. And so I encourage you tonight to push your heart and your mind and even some goals for this week towards enjoying the work of the Spirit in your life by meditating on God's word, by prayer, by taking the sacrament, by coming to church, by enjoying all that the Spirit can remind you of, that Jesus has accomplished your healing and your forgiveness, that Satan is bound. Enjoy that. Stay there. Live in God's kingdom under Christ's rule with the Holy Spirit working. Live there. Now, the other option is to declare Satan as your king. Jesus doesn't allow us a third way. So I encourage you tonight. I encourage myself and anyone listening, submit your heart to the kingship of Jesus. Anything else is unforgivable. Once you've seen and heard who Jesus is, to resist that truth, to maybe ascribe who he is to Satan, or just to declare that you don't believe the Holy Spirit exists, to assume the worst about the kingdom of God, it is akin to condemnation. It's what Jesus wants us to know. So flee from that. Flee from that to his kingdom. His kingdom has come. It's a place of healing and forgiveness. Now let's rest there by the power of the Spirit this week. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, we declare and believe and trust that only by the work of Christ, binding Satan, and by the work of the Spirit, communicating this truth to our hearts, are we justified in your sight. And we confess that Jesus has bound Satan, triumphed over him in the cross, and that it is by the Spirit that you bring these things to bear in our lives now. And please enable us to submit to our King for our good and his glory, we pray. Amen.